the white supremacists go to the bottom of the ocean and study one grain of sand, bring it and put it under a microscope. The black person passes by and say, "What are you doing there, Ralph?" "See, I'm studying this grain of sand that I got 8,000 feet from the bottom of the ocean." "And what are you studying a grain of sand for?" "I'm studying it because it's there. And I'm going to find out why it's there. And I'm going to find out everything about it, how it got there, what it does while it was there, what it can be used for by me." To dominate you. That's how my mind works. Well, how long are you going to study it? As long as it takes to figure out how I can use it to do a job on you. Because it's there, and everything that I look at is going to be serving my purpose. Everything that I hear about, I'm going to investigate it. That's my mission. That's how I go about doing things. What are you doing today? Well, I'm going to see my buddy, and we're going to get with the shooby-doo. And that's why you'll always be subject to me. Goodbye.
How long have humans lived on this continent? Well, one prevailing answer for decades was about 14,000 years, based on the age of early human stone tools. Now, new findings add weight to the case for a longer human history in the Americas. Alice Fordham of member station KUNM in New Mexico reports.
The story begins in White Sands National Park, an ethereal landscape in southern New Mexico where waves of white gypsum dunes lap across a vast basin. That basin held a lake during the last ice age, and on its dried-out banks lie thousands of fossil footprints of mammoths, giant sloths, and humans. In 2021, researchers from the Park Service, the U.S. Geological Survey, and others published a paper in the journal Science saying those footprints were between 21,000 and 23,000 years old, and that was controversial.
These ages were really much older than sort of the accepted paradigm of when humans entered North America.
Kathleen Springer is one of the U.S. Geological Survey researchers. She says scientists had thought humans might have crossed from what's now Siberia to Alaska at the end of the last ice age as glaciers retreated. Maybe that was wrong. And if it was,
it opens up whole avenues of migratory pathways. How did people get here?
But critics challenged the research. Some said the dating technique used was flawed. It tested seeds from water plants embedded along with the footprints. But those plants can absorb older carbon from water, skewing the results. So, after some pandemic delays, the researchers returned to the trench, this time to carbon date tree pollen for better accuracy. Also, they took samples of the lake bed.
They're like tubes pounded in the sedimentary sequence and taken back to a laboratory and analyzed.
For those samples, they used a different technique that looks at the luminescent properties inside quartz crystals, which change with age. Today, a new paper is out with results from both tests, and the scientists say they confirmed their original findings. Jeff Pigotti, also from the U.S. Geological Survey, hopes it'll close the case.
People can argue against any single dating technique, but it's the totality of the study, the congruence of the ages from all three different dating techniques that really make our results exceptionally robust.
Well, not so fast, says Lauren Davis, professor of anthropology at Oregon State University, who co-authored that critical paper last year. He does think the new research is important, but
I unfortunately don't share their conclusions that they have resolved the issue of timing of when people were making these footprints.
He says the samples of quartz came from the very lower deposit of the study area, and that the possible age range is broad.
All they really are telling us is that the clay that underlies all the footprints is potentially as young as 16,000 and potentially older than 21,000. That's pretty uncertain.
The debate is sure to continue. But other sites that might be older than 14,000 years are starting to get more attention, too.
Things are changing extremely rapidly.
Edward Jolie is a professor of anthropology at the University of Arizona who worked on the Footprints Project.
What's exciting about the White Sands discoveries is that they really kind of force us again to entertain this notion that significant parts of what we thought we knew or understood are in need of some serious revision.
Jolie is of Oglala Lakota and Hidalgo Muscogee heritage. He says technology is transforming his field. And another thing is that more indigenous people are involved in research into these early Americans. He says new voices are asking different questions and moving toward new answers. For NPR News, I'm Alice Vorden in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
That's one of the six basic strategies that the white supremacists are using now. And that is racial dislocation, confusion. The key word here is confusion, but the word dislocation also is very important because it means you are forced to move from one place to another. Dislocation is not the same as relocation. Relocation is when you voluntarily go from one place to another, whether it's one house to another, one apartment to another, or one town to another, one area to another, but you do it voluntarily. Dislocation is when you are being forced to. Now, the white supremacists have to be able to make black people, non-white people, move from one place to another. They're not going to give that up. That goes with the package, the entire package of the system of white supremacy itself.
Black residents question Ocean Springs development plans that single out their homes. Mary Gibson was born, raised and married in the house on School Street near downtown Ocean Springs where she thought she would also spend her final days. Now, the 73-year-old is not so sure. High-end residential development and commerce are overtaking downtown Ocean Springs between Government Street and heavily traveled US 90, also known as Bienvenue Boulevard. The house that Gibson's father built sits just off US 90. It is one of numerous black-owned homes or lots in or near the downtown area that a proposed urban renewal plan singles out for redevelopment. The administration proposes a total of 6 urban renewal areas throughout the city where development would be guided and federal funding would be available for qualified projects. Within those areas, pictures and descriptions show dozens of houses, lots and businesses that are blighted, have redevelopment potential, or both. Many residents were surprised to find their properties on the list and outraged that they learned only recently about the city's plans. Residents of the black community in and near downtown were particularly upset that a close-knit neighborhood with its roots in the late 1800s would be slated for redevelopment or labeled as blighted. It's got the community in an uproar, Gibson said. The reaction has prompted Mayor Kenny Holloway to hold off on bringing the plan up for a vote before the Planning Commission and then the Board of Aldermen. Instead, the city will host a community meeting at 6 p.m. Monday at the Ocean Springs Civic Center on Bienvenue Boulevard to hear from residents. We take full responsibility for not rolling out this plan the way it should have been rolled out, Holloway told the Sun-Herald. That's why we're pumping the brakes to get community input. Downtown Ocean Springs development underway. Government Street through downtown Ocean Springs is changing fast. The area has attracted investors who've constructed new buildings for restaurants, bars, a boutique hotel and high-end homes. One city block, at or near where a garment factory was once located, has been fenced off for construction of high-end condominiums and another boutique hotel. Ocean Springs has the state's number one school district and has been included on regional and even national lists as a great place to visit. As a result, Holloway said, more investors have been attracted to the city with a population estimated at 18,662. Less than 5% of the city's population is black. In the black neighborhood downtown, known as the Quarters, families have handed down property for generations. Many of those residents are older and live through segregation. They've been called the N-word and attended Elizabeth H. Key's colored school, one resident recalled. They studied from outdated textbooks. Their experiences have left them skeptical of plans proposed by the city's white leadership. Their trust was even further eroded when a member of the Volunteer Historic Preservation Committee was caught on a hot mic saying the old houses downtown should be burnt down. Walter Harrison, an Ocean Springs resident who married into Gibson's family, said black residents once had to accept the way they were treated. But the right to vote changed all that. The feelings that people have on this are not going away, Harrison said. We're not going to just turn over and let this happen. Black community questions urban renewal plan. Based on community reaction, the mayor has already tempered the city's plans. While the urban renewal plan singles out properties to be bought by the city and offered for private redevelopment, Mayor Holloway now says residents can opt out of urban renewal areas. He has promised the city, under his leadership, will not force anyone to sell their residential property through eminent domain. Instead, he said, residents will be offered the option of remaining in urban renewal areas so their properties might qualify for loans or grants. Residents say they want the fabric of their community maintained. Holloway insists he wants to see the same, with a mix of residential and commercial development downtown. The Gibsons are willing to sell the family home, Mary Gibson said, as long as they are fairly compensated. I don't want to give it to them and have them just stick me somewhere, she said. I want to live comfortably. I'm stuck between a rock and a hard place. Charles Burns, who owns multiple residential properties downtown, including the home where he lives, believes the city's goal is to redevelop the entire area. They just want to get all the black people out of here, Burns said. I know this. They want all the property. This story was originally published October 2, 2023, 5:50 a.m.
Every time we do this, sucker MCs wanna battle. I'm the man they love to hate, the J.R.U.ing of Seattle. Picked up the posse on 23rd and Jackson, heading for the strip. Yes, we're looking for some action. The limo's kinda crowded, the whole car was leaning back. Maharaji's watching TV with two girlies on his lap. On Martin Luther King, the set looks kinda dead. We need a new street, so posse move ahead. We all look kinda suave, the crew you can't forget. The mix a lot posse cola ripping up the set. My posse's on Broadway.
And data from the Census Bureau shows that Seattle's median household income is $110,000 a year, but black families are earning less than half of that, making it nearly impossible to afford the average monthly rent of nearly $2,300. In this edition of Soul of the Central District, our own Brian Jackson includes us to show us new affordable housing options right here in the heart of the Central District.
Africatown Plaza makes good on the promise to build with and not just for the black community, addressing historical disparities in the construction field and giving people displaced by gentrification an opportunity to come home again.
The vision was about how to acquire land, acquire this whole block was the vision, to acquire this land to allow the black community that has called this community home for over 140 years.
Taking back the block started with the Liberty Bank building. Africatown Plaza is the next step, creating 126 new affordable apartments on the south end of the Midtown Block redevelopment. All of the units are available to families making 30 to 60% of the area median income. The Midtown Square apartments are directly next door. The two-bedroom units are listed for $3,690, while a two-bedroom at Africatown Plaza will go for $1,785.
Just being able to know that you have a place to call home and that you can afford that rent, live in the central area and not have to be, you know, make six figures to live here is going to make a really big impact on lots of families.
In addition to addressing housing inequalities, Africatown Plaza made a commitment to secure a black general contractor, and just under 50% of the subcontractors, including mechanical, electrical, and plumbing work, are also black.
Building with community, not just building forward community, including those that are often excluded, you know, systemically from opportunities, you know, such as to be the general contractor on a project of this scale, to have architects, you know, being able to design from a black cultural or Afrocentric design perspective.
When you see me come on site, it's like, who's this black woman who's here? It's like, I am very short in nature and stature, and I have my hair natural. So it's just like, people are surprised all the time. We have a foldable partition or foldable wall that's here, and you can open that up, and then anything you have on the plaza, you can have it come through. So it's really kind of an open air space, and then there'll be a wall that's between the spaces, the residential amenity, and the residential lobby, but that'll be openable, so you can have parties right through here. But also it's an ability for people to open up doors and to say, okay, we have Africatown Plaza, we know that this can be done. Really for the building, it's about a love letter to the Central District, and you have just kind of touch points. What really makes the Central District or Central Area important to the African American and Pan-African community? So touches of craft, jazz, and really just making sure that there's semblance and meaning throughout everything. And we shouldn't be afraid to actually put our dollars behind projects like this. And affordable housing projects don't have to be a run-of-the-mill. They can really have iconic points of nature and really just stand the test of time.
Construction on Africatown Plaza is over 75% complete. The goal is for the project to be finished by the end of the year, with people being able to move in sometime in January. Rental applications are currently being accepted, and there's a phone line open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. For more details, visit this story on our website at fox13seattle.com.
Mr. Doe, going on in your country right now in Vietnam is 4,000 little kids who are in quarantine camps away from their parents because of this fake scamdemic. And you come to my country and you act like one of these communist parasites, I ask you to go the f*** back to Vietnam.
Lord, it is impossible to talk about Seattle's Chinatown International District without mentioning Ron Chu. The journalist and community organizer has been a community leader in the neighborhood for decades. His family's connection goes way back.
My grandfather came here in 1911, settled, lived down here in Chinatown. So I feel strong investment in the neighborhood.
Chu is best known as the former director of the Wing Luke Asian Museum, helping it grow from a cornerstone neighborhood entity into a nationally recognized one-of-its-kind jewel. He is a mentor to many across the city, including at the museum. We wanted to sit down with him in the CID as the Wing Luke and the neighborhood reels from what police call a hate crime at the museum earlier this month. I first asked him about his reaction to that vandalism.
First of all, it wasn't a surprise to me. Situations involving threats, violence, anti-Asian sentiment have been part of this neighborhood for certainly as long as I can remember. I was angry. I was concerned about staff at the museum.
And this was something that happened, I believe it was just after 5 o'clock, and still took police 45 minutes, as I understand it, to respond.
Yeah, police response to situations has always been a concern to me, whether it's slowness in responding to 911 situations or really understanding the nuance of what needs to be responded to in high priority. There's a lot of work that needs to happen on that front. During the pandemic, we saw here in Chinatown International District and throughout Seattle kind of this troubling rise of anti-Asian incidents. I know some of the businesses down here were targeted, a lot of vandalism, and then a continuing, welter of situations where elderly seniors who lived in the neighborhood and immigrants were robbed and attacked and often, called certain names. So there's an undercurrent of something that's pretty ugly, an irony that I thought about. The perpetrator of the hate crime was somebody who, was lingering in the alley. And what he did was he destroyed a bunch of windows. There's an exhibit, was an exhibit in the alley about Donnie Chin, a medic in the neighborhood who unfortunately was killed in the crossfire between two rival gangs back in 2015. Donnie Chin was somebody who dealt with a lot of the folks, much like the perpetrator, folks who had certain attitudes, were racist often, and had other, behavioral health issues. I found it ironic that Donnie was not here, somebody we consider the guardian of the neighborhood, because he probably would have talked the guy out of doing what he did with the sledgehammer. There's something, I think, that's changed a little bit in the environment. We've lost that sense of feeling that, we have protection. And so that's troubling. I think we need to find ways to rebound from that sense of malaise that this neighborhood is really feeling.
When the call goes into police that someone is smashing in windows at this cultural institution, do you think that should have set off alarm bells for the police and say, hey, this may go beyond just
someone breaking a few windows?
You know, there needs to be a better way of handling these situations with more nuance and sensitivity. And I think we need to figure out ways to make the system more responsive, because the situation could have become something else. In recent months, you know, there's been real concern in this neighborhood about a lot of the homelessness crisis, drug dealing, you know, that whole area of Little Saigon up near 12th and Jackson. It's an eroding situation, but how do we deal with that so that a piece of our cultural, historic neighborhood feels protected and is able to sustain itself? We're losing businesses. You know, people don't feel safe coming here. And again, it's a long-standing issue, but I'm hopeful, while at the same time I'm critical of official response, I'm hopeful that more public resources can be devoted to investing in the neighborhood and pushing back against all of what's happening.
Where would that investment make the most sense and do the most good?
A lot of the buildings were built over a century ago, and you know, there are inadequate resources to sustain them. You know, there are social service agencies that cluster here in the neighborhood. You know, they struggle to bring the resources to the table to support the immigrant and refugee families and elderly that live down here. New projects emerging up in Little Saigon from community-based organizations that want to create a community center, new housing, new small businesses. So those enterprises need to be supported as well. Better lighting, more cleanup, more police presence, dealing with getting folks off the street who need housing.
As far as the rise in anti-Asian American violence and racism toward the community, what do you tell people who are frustrated, who maybe don't see signs that things are going to get better in that regard?
I think resources can be provided toward improving what we teach in the schools, teaching tolerance, teaching also that, you know, a lot of the building of this city was done through Asian laborers. I think a lot of people don't realize we have a long, long presence here.
And what is giving you hope these days?
I'm now a senior. I mentor younger folks who are part of another generation. They're moving down here to live. There's a friend who's starting an Asian American bookstore down the street. He's a Khmer American. You know, there are a lot of younger folks who want to rebirth this neighborhood and haven't given up on it. So I'm hopeful. I think that there's a lot of work ahead, but there are folks who are interested in and willing to put in the labor to make it happen.
Well, Ron, we appreciate your time. Thanks so much for doing this.
No, thank you, Emo.
That was Seattle community leader Ron Chu. Earlier today, the city of Seattle and the State Department of Commerce announced $100,000 in funds to assist the Wing Luke Museum with repairs following this month's attack by a man wielding a sledgehammer. That suspect has been charged with a hate crime.
So how's the college responding to this incident?
We're having a race forum.
And what's that?
A forum on race, so we can discuss the incident and the surrounding issues of race.
So the usual lip service.
No comment.
Students and fans are accused of making racist and inappropriate remarks to opposing players during a soccer match. This happened last week during the match against Virginia State University. This morning, we're hearing from members of the team and how this has affected them.
It is 2023. It's a new era. You would think that everybody just wanted to come and just enjoy the game that we all love to play and watch, but it just takes you back.
So that was Caitlin Ritchie, a member of Virginia State's soccer team. This is the first ever season for the women's soccer team. The university's vice president says this is the school's first time dealing with a situation like this. The team's coach says the sport promotes equality and togetherness. And he says these comments cast a shadow over the success the team has had so far. Players say this isn't going to prevent the team from moving forward.
I would just hope that they learn, that they grow, and, yeah, be able to move forward, learn from this.
We received a statement this morning from Guilford College. It says, in part, this type of behavior displayed by spectators is unacceptable and will not be tolerated. President Kyle Farnberry directed the athletics director to investigate what happened. After multiple interviews and review of video and audio, the heckling started from a group of 14 people. The investigation found the comments were unsportsmanlike, and the three students were brought up on student conduct disciplinary action. The college says the investigation did not discover any evidence that racist remarks were directed by Guilford fans toward the players. Officials say the face players and fans of the opposing team felt unwelcome, and this is a deep concern, and action has been taken. Dr. Farnberry ended by saying this type of behavior is not accepted and will not be tolerated. He reached out to VSU's president to apologize, and Guilford College's athletic director apologized to VSU's associate vice president for athletics. VSU acknowledged the administration's efforts but said its student athletes also deserve a direct apology.
I don't want us to lose sight that things are getting better. Each successive generation seems to be making progress in changing attitudes when it comes to race. Doesn't mean we're in a post-racial society. It doesn't mean that racism is eliminated. But you know, when I talk to Malia and Sasha, and I listen to their friends and I see them interact, they're better than we are. They're better than we were on these issues. And that's true in every community that I've visited all across the country.
Some parents in a St. Charles County school district taking administrators to task tonight.
They say students are attacking their children with racist slurs. Melanie Johnson spoke to families who say the district is missing the mark when it comes to addressing racism. Melanie.
Sam and Corey, one mom tells me she pulled her son out of a Wentzville school because, according to her, the racist behavior was just too much. Tonight, one family details how hurtful it has been for their high school senior to be called a racial slur repeatedly, saying it happened as recently as last week.
This is my baby. You understand? Like, my job as a parent is to protect my kids.
Laisha Moore got choked up while recounting how her daughter is being called racial slurs on the school bus. Now this mom fighting for accountability.
And the fact that she has to put in her headphones to try to drown them out, it's not okay.
Her child is a senior at Timberland High School in the Wentzville School District.
My niece gets on the bus and she hears the words, "I hate N-words." How much more bold could you be?
Tamira King is her aunt and also has a daughter in the district.
Her very first day riding the school bus, the first thing she hears, "Oh my God, here comes another colored person." First day. Do you know how hard that was for her? Nerve-wrenching. It is heartbreaking and it's disturbing, and I'm tired of it. It's not one time that she was referred to as the N-word. It's multiple times a week.
The pair says despite reaching out to school officials, they have not given them a call or given a severe enough punishment like removing the students from school.
Our kids are being attacked. The children that were responsible for that, from my understanding, we're given in-school suspension and a few days off the bus.
They're going to keep doing it because nobody's doing anything about it.
Allegations of racism at Wentzville schools apparent from other parents, too. Many heading to Facebook to express what they say their kids are going through. One says, quote, "My son has had to stand up and threaten other students to get it to stop." Another writes, "My nephew is getting picked on because he's mixed." And a former student says, quote, "I graduated in 2006 and dealt with it for years."
They have to do something. So if we got to go to the very top, we will do so.
The Wentzville School District sent me a statement saying racism is not tolerated in the district. And quote, the Wentzville School District is committed to fostering an environment free from harassment and discrimination. Any action that does not align with that commitment is met with a thorough investigation and appropriate disciplinary measures in alignment with district policy. The parents we spoke to today say they are scheduled to meet with school leaders tomorrow. Melanie Johnson, First Alert 4.
We begin with breaking news tonight. A 14-year-old Pike County boy, his brother. Again, let me repeat myself to make sure that you are able to hear me. A 14-year-old Pike County boy faces murder charges in the shooting of his brother. Investigators say he confessed after his 17-year-old brother went missing this week. News 4's Ken Curtis is live in our newsroom with details of this disturbing story. Ken, what can you tell us?
Well, Kinsley, according to investigators, that 14-year-old you talk about, publicly a name, confided in a classmate at Pike County High School in Brundage that he killed his older brother. The suspect asked a friend to help him murder the remainder of his family, indicated he planned to shoot up his school. Pike County deputies say they found a hit list in his book bag. However, before he could act on the threats, Pike County deputies took that boy into custody. The body of his alleged victim, his brother, was found on the family's property in the Monticello community. That's near Banks, around 10 miles north of Brundage. Investigators say the 14-year-old shot his sibling at the back of their house, then dragged the body for about 60 yards. Now, within the last few minutes, we heard from a couple of people vital to this case, Pike County Sheriff Russell Thomas and Pike County District Attorney James Tarbox.
This student was taking a test, and he was so bothered by what this 14-year-old friend had told him that he reported it to the teacher, who then relayed the information on to the administration.
We always talk about see something, say something. That is what that friend did in this moment. And but for that friend coming forward to his teacher, having trust in his teacher, feeling comfortable to make that statement, we may have additional deaths on our hands here in Pike County at the hands of this 14-year-old that's now in custody.
As this story unfolds, I want to share with you a quote, a statement, if you will, that we received just a few minutes ago from the Pike County School Superintendent, pointing out that out of an abundance of caution, that the school system has requested an increased law enforcement presence on its campus in Brundage and is also being mindful of mental health, wellness, and support for students and staff. Again, with the arrest of that 14-year-old, there's no indication anybody is at threat. But again, out of an abundance of caution, there's going to be extra law enforcement. James Tarbox, the district attorney, told me that just a few minutes ago, Kinsley, when I spoke with him via the telephone.
A very disturbing and heartbreaking story. Ken, talk about juvenile laws while we have you.
Well, I asked Mr. Tarbox, and we talked about it. Because he's 14, he can't be named. The suspect cannot be named under Alabama laws. As far as charges and whether he'll be tried as an adult, that's something that will unfold. It'll take a while, Mr. Tarbox saying that there'll be a full evaluation of this case. And whether he's certified as an adult or not, that will be a decision not of prosecutors, but of a judge who will consider the facts of the case before making that decision, Kinsley.
But Ken, we had a 14-year-old murder suspect in Dothan last year, and police named him. What's the difference?
The difference was that suspect was at large, and a circuit court judge decided that the threat to public safety was so great that it warranted him issuing an order that police could release that 14-year-old's name. As soon as the arrest took place, that information became private, even though we learned the name during that period of time when the search was on for him. And ultimately, that 14-year-old Vincent Oliver Jr. was certified as an adult to stand trial, a trial that's pending on capital murder charges. A lot developing, more tonight at 10 in this case, Kinsley.
Yes, very interesting stuff. Ken Curtis, thank you so much for breaking that down for us. And we're continuing to follow this story, like Ken mentioned, and learn more about the investigation into what exactly happened.
Since you're my special friend, come closer for a special treat. I'm going to let you touch me in a special place.
It is never okay to touch someone else's private parts. Your mom and dad will tell you so.
We begin tonight with two people behind bars accused in the killing of a Pontiac man known for pursuing sexual predators. Thank you for joining us at 10. I'm Simon Chaquette. Robert Lee, known as Bupak Shakur, was shot and killed at Universal Coney Island in Pontiac last night. Lee had a large social media following and would pose as young girls online, then record confrontations with sexual predators whom he communicated with. Tonight, friends and family gathering to host a vigil for Lee. 7 Action News reporter Tiara Braddock has a closer look at Lee's history and this warning from law enforcement.
Robert Lee, a.k.a. Bupak Shakur, made it his mission to expose child predators. Last night, he was killed right here inside this Coney Island. Tonight, people gathered around it to pay their respects.
I talked to a lot of victims, and they appreciate what I do.
That was Robert Lee back in January. For a little over a year, the Pontiac native used social media to pose as underage girls to catch sexual predators. He would forward his conversations to police. Lee would even confront the would-be predators himself. Videos like this one were posted on Lee's Facebook page of him confronting alleged predators. This video has almost 3,000 views.
Certainly, he was a very well-intentioned person, you know, very much in alignment with our philosophy. We want to see child predators taken off the street, held accountable. We want to protect kids.
Lee was fatally shot inside Universal Coney Island near North Perry and MLK Boulevard late Friday night. Oakland County Sheriff Michael Bouchard says Lee confronted two men who were inside the restaurant. He even accused one of the men of being a pedophile.
The confrontation escalated very quickly, and ultimately the second individual in the booth produced a firearm and shot him multiple times.
Police have arrested the two suspects involved in Lee's shooting. They haven't released their names because they haven't been formally charged yet. According to Sheriff Bouchard, Lee's one-man crusade led to arrest and criminal charges of several men. The sheriff says this type of vigilantism can be very dangerous. He doesn't recommend people confronting predators.
Oftentimes, if you actually corner a predator, sometimes they become violent. They get trapped. They, you know, try to get away using any means at their fingertips.
Meanwhile, Lee will be missed by his family, friends, and the fans of his work.
He really changed a lot of lives. He really cared about the kids of the community. He wanted to keep everyone's kids safe, and he was just a really, really caring person in the community. He really cared about this city a lot.
In Pontiac,
the man knot, race, class, genre, and the dilemmas of black manhood.
And now at 5:30, an eye-opening new report on trends involving the arrests of young people. Good evening, I'm Jim Barry.
And I'm Lauren Pastrana in for Naja tonight. Only CBS News Miami is getting a look at that report tonight. It found while black youth represent 17% of the population, they accounted for 63% of arrests in 2022.
A forum to discuss these findings is getting underway right now. CBS News Miami's Morgan Reiner has a closer look.
The report is not all bad news. There's actually been a decrease in the number of youth arrested over the last decade. But of the youth that are being arrested, there are troubling trends. And tonight, hundreds of people are going to pack this hall to talk about how to reverse those trends.
From 2010 to 2022, University of Miami researchers found that youth arrests decreased in Miami-Dade County by 76%.
A lot of that can be attributed to diversion programs where first-time offenders show remorse, pick up some skills, you know, learn their lessons, but not have that scarlet letter of a criminal conviction.
Dr. Marcus Bright is the Youth Services Administrator for the Miami-Dade County Economic Advocacy Trust.
Black boys made up 9% of the youth population and 52% of the arrests. So obviously we see we believe that that is a crisis.
A crisis, he says, has lasting impacts.
One arrest, for whatever reason, means that they could be discriminated against when it comes to employment opportunities, when it comes to housing, when it comes to education.
So Thursday evening, it's time to talk about it. School board members, state politicians, police chiefs, and a list of community stakeholders will participate in discussing solutions. He says the report recommends a public option for universal early learning coverage.
Studies show that if a child is reading fluently by the third grade, they're six times more likely to graduate high school. And so if we can deal with that problem upstream, then that will reduce the propensity for them to engage in activities that may lead to their incarceration.
More mental health professionals.
We believe that there should also be a mental health coordinator in every school, and there should be double, triple, quadruple the investment in mental health professionals so that young people can be equipped to deal with their emotions.
And bringing more exposure of high-paying career paths into schools.
How can you aspire to be an engineer if you've never seen one? And so we want to be intentional about providing exposure to new and these emerging career pathways, particularly in high-wage industries, as we know that Miami is the most unaffordable housing market in the country.
Dr. Bryce says this is not just a moment, but rather a movement, the first of many conversations to come. In Miami Gardens, Morgan Reiner, CBS News, Miami.
To read the full report about higher arrest rates for African-American boys, click on this story on CBSMiami.com. It's right on our homepage. At 7, we talk live with the Miami-Dade Economic Advocacy Trust, which arranged that study, along with the University of Miami.
The ones that I add to it, stop using and selling drugs to one another. See, we're getting ready to be put in a real trap with this legalization of marijuana. So everybody, every black person can be unemployed and then they can sit in their corner and get high on marijuana with whatever they decide to put in it. And people won't be asking for jobs and being determined that they're going to get jobs and going to get an education. No, everybody can start getting high on marijuana because somebody said it's medicinal and it's legal.
What about?
So we better beware.
And now it's another edition of the Midday Health Watch with Dr. Leana Wen, one of the most respected public health experts in the country. She's a former health commissioner of Baltimore, columnist on health matters for The Washington Post, a medical expert on CNN, and a scholar at George Washington University and the Brookings Institution. She's also a great friend of Midday. Dr. Wen joins us on Zoom. Leana, always a pleasure to have you.
Great to be with you as always, Tom.
You wrote a couple of columns, more than a couple, I think maybe, about psychedelics and their use in the treatment of mental health disorders, PTSD, severe depression. You wrote about some dangers associated with the prevalence of this, of employing these psychedelics in these kinds of therapies. Really fascinating stuff in the Washington Post. The medical promise of psychedelics are certainly quite substantial. What do you think?
Yeah, so I wrote about these hallucination-inducing drugs called psychedelics. So specifically two of these drugs, which is psilocybin, also known as magic mushrooms, and MDMA, which is also known as ecstasy. So there have been some studies published in very respected journals like JAMA and Nature Medicine that show that these drugs are very promising for treating severe depression in the case of psilocybin and PTSD in the case of MDMA or ecstasy. But what I wrote about is that allowing for medical purpose is not the same as widespread recreational access. If you look at the way that the studies were done, they were done in a very, very specific way. With psilocybin, it was a single dose of psilocybin in a very controlled environment combined with psychotherapy before, during, and after psilocybin administration. With MDMA, it was three different of these cycles, including the observation itself when somebody was on either MDMA or psilocybin was 6 to 10 hours long just for that single setting observed by therapists. And there is a very significant concern, which is that if people think that, well, if medical use is fine, then I should just be using it myself for recreational purposes, they are not taking into account the potential harms, including triggering psychosis, worsening suicidality. You need someone there to manage these side effects. It's also important to note that these studies that I mentioned that are very promising excluded individuals who are deemed to be at high risk from these side effects. They excluded, for example, people with bipolar disorder, people with a prior history of psychosis, people even with a first degree relative who had psychosis. And so we don't have any idea what it's going to be like if these drugs are distributed in a recreational way, but that is already happening. They are already being legalized in Oregon and Colorado. 25 states have had pieces of legislation introduced to legalize these psychedelics. And I just really worry that this is following the same path, frankly, as cannabis, as marijuana, that the conversation around medical use is very appropriate and we should be doing these studies. And by the way, these psychedelic drugs are on track to being FDA approved by next year, by 2024. But I also don't think that should mean that states should jump the gun, so to speak, and allow for recreational use. I mean, we don't allow this for any other aspect of medical care. We don't say, hey, there's some cancer drugs. Let's just make them widely available. You can get chemotherapy on the street. I mean, we don't say that for any other form of medical care, and we really shouldn't do that for psychedelics either.
Yeah, it's interesting how it could easily get wrapped up in the whole, change of heart about cannabis. It started as medical cannabis, now recreational cannabis here in Maryland and for 20-plus states across the country. It can be used recreationally, but boy, these psychedelics, using them outside of a clinical setting without professionals keeping an eye on you and doing, as you say, therapy prior to, after, and even during the time that you're taking these substances. It's a very different thing. I mean, ecstasy is a drug that we've heard about a lot as a party drug, as a drug that a lot of young people were certainly experimenting with for years ago, and we read about all sorts of horror stories about things happening because people were taking that drug in an uncontrolled setting. So it is interesting how this could easily get tied up with the thought about cannabis and the availability of recreational cannabis. There really isn't anything the notion of recreational psychedelics is still a very dangerous thing.
And that's the concern. Look, I think the conversation has gotten a bit cloudy because I certainly don't think that we should be criminalizing these drugs and sending people to jail for long periods of time if they happen to have psychedelics. But criminalizing or decriminalizing is not the same thing as legalizing. And even if we were to legalize, that still doesn't mean that it should be safe. And I think that's the key here, that just because something is being used for medical purposes doesn't mean that its recreational use is safe. That confusion occurred with cannabis, and I really fear that it's happening with psychedelics. And there's another harm as well, which is that I worry about people with serious mental illness choosing psychedelics on their own instead of going to a psychiatrist or licensed therapist for evidence-based care. Again, we don't let people do that for any other aspect of medicine. We don't say, oh, you have cancer, go buy chemotherapy drugs on the street, or you have diabetes, go buy diabetes medication on the street. No, we really should be treating mental health in the same way that we are treating physical health. And I really fear that the great potential of these drugs in treating some very difficult illnesses like depression, severe depression, treatment-resistant depression, there are so many patients who could really benefit from these drugs. So let's let patients use them for the appropriate purpose and let these drugs go through the FDA regulatory process instead of having states preempted with legislation.
The Turner Diaries sold over 500,000 copies. Who do you think is buying it? Eric Rudolph, the Olympic bomber, Wei Page, who shut up the Sikh temple, Larry Ford, developing typhoid and cholera, William Krar with the cyanide bomb, anthrax, ricin, botulism, C4, IEDs. I could go on like this for hours, and all of them are white supremacists.
When young men turn to places like YouTube and X, formerly Twitter, looking for male solidarity, what they often find is rage, hostile comments, depictions of the world as stacked against them. And getting swept up in these angry digital spaces can have negative consequences offline, like depression and suicide, even result in violence towards others. But some people think these problems can be addressed using the same online tools that provoked them. Our family and tech columnist Julie Jargon is here to talk about that approach and how it works. Julie, before we get into that, can you just paint us a picture of what this online manosphere is like?
So the manosphere is a broad term for any number of websites, predominantly social media websites, where men find themselves congregating with other men to talk about all different types of men's issues. Some of them can be quite negative. This organization called Diverting Hate has started cataloging some of these different types of websites, and some of the categories include the incel movement, and incel stands for people who are involuntarily celibate. Then there's the men going their own way movement, which promotes the idea that men can live fulfilling lives without women. And then there's this whole pickup artist segment of the manosphere where men give other men advice on how to pick up women and how to keep relationships with women once they are dating women, with some pretty questionable advice.
Have we seen this anger on social media, on these other online spaces, turn into a real world problem? Can you give us some examples?
There have been a couple of high profile situations, and of course these are extreme examples, but there was a young man who in 2014 killed seven people around the University of California, Santa Barbara, and he had posted a YouTube video in which he vowed to retaliate against women who he says would have rejected him. And he was said he was going after sorority houses, and he kind of got this following online as a hero to people who described themselves as incels. And then in 2018, a man in Toronto drove a van through a crowd. He killed 10 people, and he had pointed to the Santa Barbara killer on Facebook as someone he looked up to.
You know, now there's this group that believes they can stop the anger by using some of the same tools, the same social media platforms that have helped stoke it. Can you tell us a little bit more about their approach?
There's an organization called Diverting Hate, which grew out of a university graduate school research program, and they secured $700,000 in funding from the Department of Homeland Security to enact their program, in which they're trying to target men where they are, which is in these online communities, with posts and tweets that speak to them in the language that they're accustomed to seeing on these sites, and then steering them to men's organizations that they've partnered up with that are trying to help men through positive means find community and therapy if needed.
Do we know how well it's working?
It's still early days. They've just started running these ads and posts over the last 3 months. So far, they've had 700,000 impressions, and 1% of the men who've seen those ads have clicked onto the content, which is actually a pretty decent social media engagement rate. But what they haven't yet measured and what they don't yet know is how many of those men who've clicked through those sites will actually join some of those groups, go on retreats, subscribe to the YouTube channels of more positive content creators, or even seek mental health help.
And what comes next for the group and its efforts?
Well, they're going to continue widening their reach. They have a $60,000 advertising budget for the next 12 months, which is not a huge amount of money to spend, but they feel like that's a start. But they have acknowledged that it's going to be very challenging to get people to join these support groups. And, you know, they're up against social media accounts that have huge followings. So I looked up some of these accounts online, and there was one X account, formerly Twitter, that was dedicated to teaching men how to quickly seduce women. And the last I checked, it had nearly 130,000 followers just on that one account alone.
We're talking about posts online. We're talking about anger online. Your story has gotten quite a lot of comments. As of Wednesday, it was over 900 comments. What have these been like, and how different is that from some of the other stories that you've covered?
That's a lot of comments on one story. If I have, you know, a couple hundred, that's really good in terms of engagement with readers. But in addition to the comments that readers have left directly on the story, there have been a lot of posts on X, and I've received a lot of reader email. And some of that email and some of those comments have been very angry from men who say, you know, that as a woman, I shouldn't be writing about
solutions to men's problems. Some are kind of complaints from men about why they feel the world is stacked against them, and it's not really anger directed at me per se, but where they're just kind of voicing their frustration about things in their life that aren't going their way and trying to provide an explanation for why men feel the way they do. I haven't heard from too many women, though, on this one.
All right, that's our family and tech columnist, Julie Jargon. Thanks for joining us.
Medical apartheid, the dark history of medical experimentation on Black Americans from colonial times to the present.
Baby guts are a wildly active place. All sorts of bacteria, both the good and the bad, set up there during our diaper stage and continue doing so throughout childhood. A recent study led by a Washington University researcher shows that gut biome differences begin between 3 and 12 months of age, and what happens in the kid gut biome can put us on track for various tangible impacts and disparities that show up in health conditions and outcomes long after we're out of our nappies. Liz Malott is the author of that study and assistant professor of biology at Washington University in St. Louis, and she joins us now to talk about her findings. Liz, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
So let's set the stage. What is a gut biome, and why should we care what's in it?
Yeah, so your gut biome, or your gut microbiome, it's a collection of all of the different microorganisms that live in your intestines and in your stomach. So it's bacteria, which is mostly what we think about, but also viruses, fungi, protists, and other little single-celled organisms that are running around in there.
Mm-hmm.
And those microbes are actually really important. Some of them are harmful or are sometimes harmful, but most of them are neutral or helpful.
Mm-hmm.
They constantly interact with us, and they do things like break down food you can't digest on your own, like the stringy bits of celery. Your gut microbes break that down and give you energy from it.
So is that part of the interaction that you were talking about?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What are some of the interactions that we maybe are not as conscious of but are happening all the time?
Yeah. So they are also involved in regulating our blood sugar and our blood pressure. They can increase or decrease inflammation. And they also protect us from pathogens. So bacteria that want to invade your normal healthy gut microbiome will actually help keep them out of your system.
Mm-hmm. Now, you examined data for the study that we opened with, that was collected from nearly 730 children in the U.S. between birth and 12 years of age. Yeah. What is it that you were looking to understand better, and why kids?
Yeah. So we knew from studies in the U.S. and worldwide that if you looked at the gut microbiome of adults, we could see differences that were associated with racial groups or ethnic groups, the different classifications that are used in different parts of the world. But we weren't really sure when those occurred. We do know, though, that some of those differences in adults are linked to things related to health disparities. So differences in rates or severity of disease that are tied to social and environmental factors.
Mm-hmm.
So we were curious, When do these differences appear? At what point in childhood? Sort of so we could both figure out what time period to target for interventions, but also sort of narrow down what sort of social and environmental factors might be most important,
mm-hmm.
because kids of different ages are exposed to different things.
Right. And they expose us to different things too.
Yes.
Now, before we came into the studio, one of the things that I noted was that there are many from St. Louis who are part of the data that you were looking at. Why is that the case?
So Washington University's medical school was one of sort of the early places where a lot of gut microbiome research was going on. And a couple of investigators there, Jeff Gordon and Barbara Warner, enrolled a lot of twins in an early study. And they've made the data from that study publicly available,
mm-hmm.
And which has been really helpful. And so we included it in our work.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is it that this study then contributes to, or updates what we understand about the development of one's gut microbiome?
Yeah. So during that first 3 months of life, really early in infancy, we actually don't see any differences based on race and ethnicity. Of course, the gut microbiome is developing during that time period, but it really seems to be tied to other factors, like whether or not you're formula fed or breastfed. But something happens after 3 months, either at 3 months or shortly after, where you do start to see a slight divergence in the gut microbiome between Black, White, and Asian Pacific Islander kids, or then Hispanic and non-Hispanic kids.
Mm-hmm. Was there one disparity in particular that really stood out to you as you were doing this work?
I think one of the things that really stood out to me is that the taxa that we see diverge are taxa that we know we acquire from the environment. They aren't bacteria species that are inherited from your mom. They're not ones that you gain during the birth process. And they're also not ones that are heritable, that are linked to our genetics.
Mm-hmm.
So it really is something in the external environment that must be driving the change.
Mm-hmm. I mean, was that a surprise or something that you expected to find?
Oh, that's a good question. I think for me, the finding was what I expected, but that wasn't true of everyone who was part of the study.
Okay.
Some of the other investigators were surprised by the result.
Yeah. We have Maureen calling in from Wildwood. Maureen, welcome to St. Louis on the Air.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize I was going to be on the air. My question, I used to work with newborns. We would routinely give them a course of antibiotics. It was ampicillin and gentamicin, if the maternal temperature was over 100.4. And I was always concerned about the long-term effects we would have on these little guys, because often I just thought the moms were just hot from the long labor and delivery.
Mm-hmm.
So has any studies been done on the long-term impact?
Yeah, Maureen, thank you.
Yeah, Liz? Thanks, Maureen. Uh-huh. So there have been several studies that have looked at early antibiotic exposure and the development of the gut microbiome, and we do know that it does change the trajectory of the gut microbiome, and in some cases it can make kids more susceptible to later developing allergies or asthma. But I also want to say that having antibiotics when you do have an infection is very important, particularly in kids who are really susceptible to infections.
Yeah.
So I'm not a medical doctor, so I don't want
sure,
to.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
We also have Ida, who is calling from Old North St. Louis. Ida, welcome.
Hi there.
Hi.
I have questions about blood pressure. I was surprised to hear about the gut microbiome having to do with that. And I've never heard a doctor talk about it. And I come from a medical family. So, and I'm asking about high blood pressure and low blood pressure. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, most of the research has been done on high blood pressure. It's fairly recent work from a group in Australia, and they're finding that the gut microbiome really does can predispose you to having high blood pressure through something called short-chain fatty acids, which are a molecule that gut microbes produce. So if your gut microbes aren't producing enough short-chain fatty acids, you can actually develop high blood pressure. But again, this is research that has only come out in the past couple of years.
Mm-hmm. I mean, is this field of gut microbiome study, is it relatively new? I mean, Ida mentioned that her family of doctors has never mentioned it.
Yeah, so we didn't really have the tools to look at the gut microbiome until about 2009. So it is a really recent field.
Mm-hmm.
And we're learning a lot rather rapidly.
Mm-hmm. And there's a lot to learn about.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. There are some of these microbiomes that do transfer from birthing parent, from mom, mm-hmm. To the baby during birth. But most of them, as you said, they come from their environment after they're born. Which are the ones that do transfer? And do they have anything in common?
A lot of the ones that transfer early on are ones that are really important early in the life of an infant. So it's things like bifidobacteria, which is a bacteria that breaks down the sugars that are found in breast milk and formula. And so it's those sorts of bacteria that are very important early in life seem to be the ones that are transferred during birth.
Mm-hmm. Now, returning to the idea, right, about why we should care about gut bacteria, you know, we've just had this call from Ida about blood pressure, things, you know, that that happen or come to light more as we get older. I mean, what are some of the tangible negative effects, health effects that stem from poor gut health early on in life?
Yeah, so there have been a couple of large studies, both in the United States and in Canada, that have shown that differences in the gut microbiome early in life, some sort of large disturbance, either due to having a lot of antibiotics or malnutrition really early on, or being premature, that those can then increase the risk of things like type 2 diabetes mm-hmm. or severe asthma or other lung illnesses.
Right. Well, and those are conditions, I think, that insofar as what I have heard, they do correlate with race and ethnicity.
They do.
You know, what were the differences that were starkest among the various races and ethnicities that you studied?
I think the biggest difference, the largest effect size, was in the diversity of the gut microbiome. And that is how many species of bacteria are present in an individual infant or child's stool. And what we're finding actually is that kids who their parents identify them or they self-identify as Black have higher gut bacterial diversity. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we tend to think of as something that is beneficial.
Yeah.
The more diverse the gut microbiome is, the more resilient it is to outside infections,
mm-hmm.
Which that was rather surprising.
Yeah.
But we aren't able to follow these kids longitudinally, so we don't know how their gut bacteria will continue to change.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is it that can and should be done then, given this information that we now have, and particularly from like a public health standpoint, what can we do?
Yeah, so what I'm really hoping that folks, the other researchers will do, is look at individual factors that are correlated with race and ethnicity to try to figure out what is actually driving these differences.
Mm-hmm.
There are things like exposure to pollution, what childcare looks like early on, whether or not a kid is in daycare or mm-hmm. is cared for by family members or has a nanny, the introduction of different foods early in life, all of those could be driving these differences, and we really just don't know what specific factor it is.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hoping that folks will sort of go after those.
Yeah. We're speaking with Liz Malott, who is an assistant professor of biology at Washington University in St. Louis. We're discussing some of the findings from a recent study about the child gut biome.
We're going to pause this for the benefit of all y'all who never saw Soul Food. Soul Food is a movie about a big, humongous Black grandmother, aptly named Big Mama. Big Mama demonstrates her love by feeding herself and her offspring enormous amounts of kid lard. Then, get this, Big Mama's arteries are so clogged, they gotta amputate her arm.
It was her leg.
Right, okay, whatever, leg. Then, she dies of a heart attack. Or another stroke, or something.
God called her home.
And what does the family do after she dies? They get together for a Sunday dinner and eat the same food that just killed Big Mama. The same food! They didn't learn a lesson. Nobody went on a diet, and that's the end of the movie.
The world is guzzling more sugary beverages. NPR's Ari Daniel has word of a new study that ranks countries by their intakes.
Growing up in Mexico, Laura Lara Castor went to her fair share of social gatherings. Sweet beverages abounded.
In my family or in reunions, people would actually drink a lot of these sodas, so I could see like firsthand how it could be contributing to these diseases.
Diseases like diabetes and cardiovascular problems,
which to date are the leading causes of death and years lost of disability in many countries.
Castor is now a nutrition PhD candidate at Tufts University, and she and her colleagues set out to see how global consumption of sugar-sweetened drinks has changed over the last few decades. Drinks like sodas, energy drinks, juices, and aguas frescas. Castor found that globally, we were slurping up 16% more of these libations in 2018 than we were in 1990. But there were regional differences.
The largest increases like over time were in the sub-Saharan Africa.
Castor has a theory.
They are a target for certain food industries, such as soda.
She thinks that's because there's more money moving around in some of these countries. Their economies are expanding and the middle class is growing.
So there's been more marketing. Also, in some countries, the Western diet is like still seen as status.
Meanwhile, in 2018, Latin America was the region that consumed the most sugar-sweetened drinks, with Castor's home country of Mexico topping the list. On the flip side, Brazil saw the largest decrease in consumption over that same 28-year span, which, says Castor, could be due to more awareness that sugary drinks can be bad for your health. These findings are published in the journal Nature Communications.
The paper, it gives us a real picture of what's happening in terms of sugar consumption.
Dr. Ikeola Adoye is an epidemiologist at the University of Ibadan in Nigeria. She says in her country, she sees sugar drinks everywhere.
It's not so expensive. It's not seen as harmful to health. So it's widely drunk in Nigeria.
Beyond educating people, Adeoye argues that policy interventions are key, like warning labels or soda taxes. These approaches have been successful in higher-income countries, which in general have seen the largest decreases in drinking sweet beverages. Ari Daniel, NPR News.
Saying if it was not for the white people who practice racism, white supremacy, Mr. President Obama would not be in the White House.
If any black person who forgets that is getting forgetting a very important fundamental, he couldn't even been running. His name would have not been known. He wouldn't have had a white mother in Kansas.
A former Kansas City, Kansas police detective facing explosive federal charges is in a hospital tonight. 70-year-old Roger Golubski is temporarily freed from certain conditions of his home release, including the wearing of an ankle monitoring device. Fox 4's Jacob Kilsad live at the Dole Federal Courthouse in downtown KCK. Jake, do we know what Golubski's health issue is?
No, we don't, John, but we did hear in earlier court appearances about his need for dialysis as well as other health issues that eventually led to him being granted house arrest. However, none of this information is reassuring to the people who call themselves his victims.
I take 8 pills once a week. Give me the medicine off my table.
Ophelia Williams-Petway says her health is also worsening, waiting for trial.
They will identify themselves as police officers.
This is video of Roger Golubski in 2000. That same year, Ophelia says that's when she had her run-in with him.
When he took my son and then came back and raped me, you know, I was like, man, it's nothing I could do. I don't even look at him that long. You know, he just still looked the same to me, a dirty old.
This is more recent video of Golubski headed into court for the federal charges, including abuses of power going back decades, like conspiring to run a sex trafficking operation. The charges follow a $12.5 million settlement in civil court. Where attorneys for Lamont McIntyre argued Golubski was a key figure in his wrongful conviction. McIntyre spent 23 years in prison before he was cleared and released.
For as long as the Department of Justice has been in this case, they've known that it's going to be a race with the Grim Reaper to bring this guy to justice.
Sean O'Brien is a professor of law at UMKC. He's represented some of Golubski's reported victims, disturbed by this change.
So this is a classic case of justice delayed is justice denied. I mean, this is a fellow who used his position as a police officer not only to say take advantage of citizens is a gross understatement. He raped women.
Every time I get stressed, my sugar goes up.
Ophelia frames the situation differently.
But I got congestive heart failure. I can go anytime. I don't think God would let him go like that. I don't think the devil would either.
Now, we've asked Golubski's attorneys for more details on his health situation, how serious it is. We have not heard back yet. And Lauren, We do know that Golubski previously pleaded not guilty to the charges that were filed against him.
And the non-white black man, the Jamaican immigrant, as they call him, who was killed in a hunting accident with a group of white people, one of the things that I've always did, you know, especially young folks who kind of still like to party, you know, I tell my children, too, do not go to any functions with a bunch of white people. And if you happen to walk into a place where you are the only black person in there, leave immediately. This is what happens when situations like, you know, the non-white black male gets killed in a hunting accident. He went down with a group of white people, and next thing you know, he's dead. It kind of reminds me, I was just watching an episode of Unsolved Mysteries, which is on Netflix now. And one of the episodes talked about a non-white black male named Alonzo Brooks from a 2004 case. Mr. Brooks was 23 years old when he got killed. The thing is that he's disappeared and his body can't be found. So apparently what happened was he was living in a part of Kansas. And he went to a party in a town of Kansas called Lasignia with a bunch of white people. So apparently he went to the party. There was a bunch of white people there. He's coming with his white friends. And apparently there was a bunch of nigger calling and all kind of, you know, racial slurs, you know, at him. And he nearly gets into a fight. The friends that he came down to the party with left him there. And next thing you know, Mr. Brooks is gone. They can't find his body. The FBI came down and nobody in Lasignia wants to talk. So it's basically a missing persons case. The family is like, you know, it was a racial hate crime, which, you know, in a lot of sense it obviously is. But what's also interesting is, and we went over James Lowen's book, Sundown Town.
20 years after a murder near Lacine, Kansas, there's a new push by the FBI to get new information in this case. Good evening, everybody. I'm Chris Katz.
And I am Priya Berry. That push comes as the FBI is also launching a hate crime awareness campaign. KNBC 9's Andy Alcock is live outside FBI headquarters with the reason behind this development. Andy.
Priya and Chris, Alonzo Brooks was just 23 years old when he was murdered in 2004. Now, nearly 20 years later, FBI agents are investigating the possibility his murder was a hate crime.
Billboards like this one along Interstate 70 are asking for the public's help solving the murder of Alonzo Brooks. In April 2004, Brooks attended a party with roughly 100 people at this farmhouse near Lacine, Kansas. When nobody heard from him, family and friends found his body a month later at a nearby creek.
We believe that this could potentially be a crime that was motivated by a bias towards Alonzo's race.
The cause of death for Brooks was unknown until his body was exhumed in 2020. An armed forces medical examiner determined Brooks was murdered. His sister, Esperanza Roberts, told us in 2022 she believes there will be justice for her brother's murder.
A lot of it is faith, believing that we will eventually get our answers.
While it's not completely clear what happened to Brooks and why, FBI statistics show hate crimes are a very real issue, and not just for the individual victims.
It sends intimidation and fear throughout the whole community, so people are afraid to come forward.
And those seven billboards around town asking for help in the Brooks case also state there's up to a $100,000 reward for information, and you can give that information anonymously by calling the Crime Stoppers hotline at 816-474-TIPS. Reporting live outside FBI headquarters in Kansas City, Andy Alcock, KNBC 9 News.
Andy, thank you. According to the FBI, there were more than 10,000 hate crimes reported in 2021. Nearly two-thirds of victims were targeted.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. today's date, Saturday, October 7, 2023. So I have been told. Our weekly compensatory call-in. Dial in if you have observations, thoughts, counter-racist suggestions. The number 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. We will get to folks who dialed in, questions, observations, share a few thoughts on some of the news segments that we began with. We did not include in the audio official the Democracy Now! Segment on Tracy McCarter. Cowbell, woo-wee, non-white female. They were talking about her criminal prosecution for killing her former white partner in what she alleges is self-defense, and talking about what she says is racism in all of this. Cowbell, tragic arrangements. Once again, not understanding what it means to be white. And then a system of white supremacy racism. That would be another one to even think about, too. You get into some sort of sexual arrangement with a white person, male or female. If there is an argument, ooh, the police have to be called. Apparently, if you are male or female, things could go poorly for you. And in fact, I talked about this in detail about a decade ago. Non-white person right here in good old Seattle, his non-white female sister, she was so-called dating a white man. He had made his disapproval known using counter-racist logic. He had read Mr. Fuller's book, talked to him even. And so they all went for, let's say, coffee. We're in Seattle. So they all go for coffee, and they have some sort of conflict. They stop. Non-white male that I know, he attempts to call, you know, to get a ride, call an Uber, whatever it is. He's going to depart their company at this very moment. The white guy is pulling out his phone. He's going to call the police because the non. Now, get this. The non-white male and his non-white sister, they get into a verbal spat, and she pushes him physically, leaves scratches on his chest, which becomes important. The white man pulls out his phone. I'm going to call the police. Non-white male kicks the phone out of his hand. They get into a lot of histrionics. Anyway, the police, SPD, Seattle Police Department, are called. They come on the scene. The law in Washington State, if the police are called and it's some sort of domestic disturbance, if there is evidence that there was a fight, confrontation, physical of some sort, someone is going to jail, period. That is the law. That's another one to keep in mind, too. Lots of reasons for first time, last time, and be with somebody sexually that you are not going to have a lot of arguments, gripes, and complaints. Those will be minimal and not explosive. Anyway, as I told you, the non-white female, she shoved her brother repeatedly and it left scratches, even drew blood. That's all they need to see. You, young lady, are going to jail for defending your white man. And because they lock up so many niggers in Seattle. We had a Seattle attorney on the program before, non-white female, and she told us that about 40% of the cases King County Court are black males that she prosecutes. It's only 10% of the population. It's not it. Black people aren't even 10% of the county. We heard that today. But this is 2013, I think she's in the archives. Massive chunk of it is just black dudes for King County. Anyway, she gets arrested. As opposed to, you can go the next day and make bail and, you know, get out. Too crowded. Wasn't even able to see the judge until the day after. So she had to spend 2 nights in jail. Isn't that wonderful? I bet that white man was worth staying in jail a whole week for. Whole lot to discuss with those tragic arrangements. They still got that case that's being adjudicated in Florida where the white woman killed the black dude. Tragic indeed. Those would be great examples to show to your offspring. You got it both ways. Like, yeah, this, you know, really. Really. You got enough of this with black males and black females that hate each other, right? You want to add that to it? Okay. That was not included in the official audio. Already was lots to play this week. Lots had it at the beginning. Also extra. I'll do it this way. We had on Monday, still not feeling totally great, but a little bit better. Hopefully within 3 days, I'll be right as rain, as they say. Labored through it. Counter-racist grind. This past Monday, we had Dr. Louise de Tote, T-O-I-T. Should be Trois, French. She said they blunted it to be in South Africa, Afrikaners. So, de Tote. Okay, she was with us, white woman, this past Monday, way early, and I'm not even feeling well. So we're doing that broadcast. It was two of many things, but the two that I will pick out now. I told her about Dr. Alisa Savali's study. This is a white woman in Sweden where she went to South Africa, was studying the white people there and their fears about water shortages. Negroes are going to come take our water. Now, I said, it was a listener asked a question on that program with Dr. Savali way back in the springtime about white people stealing their water. And she got like an attitude about it. Dr. Savali, I didn't say that they stole the water, blah, blah, blah. And I had to go back and look at the report, like, wait a minute now. You said, and you got a direct quote that they, black people, kaffirs, they're going to come in here. They're going to take our water. Oh, and we're afraid. I said, what? Does steal mean something on the opposite hemisphere? Does the definition change? Steal means something totally different than break in and take something that does not belong to you. It does not mean that, maybe, in the eastern hemisphere. Maybe that's what it is. We talked to Dr. de Tote. And I asked her about this, the water shortages, because she said the infrastructure is crumbling. She said, in fact, she even said white people are leaving South Africa. Ah, the Negroes have ruined it. The coffers, they've ruined it. And we just can't stay. You know, the water, and they got these power shortages, and can't do it. So she said, Dr. de Tote, when I asked her, Dr. Savali did this study, she said that the white people are afraid that the black people are going to steal their water. She said, oh, that is really poorly put. I mean, really, steal the water. I mean, who's think? I went back and looked at that report again. If I had been feeling healthy, I would have read that live time. Like, wait a minute. She directly quoted your black sisters, excuse me, your white sisters and white brothers. They said, direct quote, oh, man, we are concerned. These coffers, they're going to come and take our water. Man, we got extra security and a lot. That's stealing. You think they're going to come and steal your water. What the heck? Then they have two different white people in South Africa who know that is true. White people do talk like this. They're having major water problems in South Africa. They have to have, like, water for people in, like, Southern California. They have to do the water conservation. You can't water your lawn and have to take a quick shower and all that other stuff. They have serious penalties and fines and all that. That's the sort of thing that they've been having in South Africa. And the electricity cutoffs, really bad infrastructure. And they blame that on the Negroes, too. See, this is the spawn of Madiba. See, what's happening? Anyway, but you do know that that's the way that they talk. The Negroes are going to steal our water.
why the, you know, resistance? Don't you be telling people we scared that the Kaffirs are going to steal out? Don't be saying that. Why? If that's true. That was one of many. Two, during that same program, Dr. Detote, white woman, suspected racist, she said, based on her chapter, book chapter that we were discussing about the sexual abuse of black males in South Africa, she said there is an implied sexual degeneracy about black people. And I asked her to explain, what does that mean? And she explained. Now, even in my fog of being way broadcasting very early in the morning, 6 hours earlier than our normal broadcast time, and not feeling well, even with all of that, that's important. I'm glad we got her to give more detail. Now, once the program concluded, I immediately, and once it was about 4 hours later in the day, which was still very early afternoon here in Seattle, I said, man, I would have just said the one word, kinky. That gets right to the implied sexual degeneracy of black people, because we've been talking about that term quite a bit this year. Kinky, it's implied, something sexually deviant, and that's the way that we talk about Negro hair. Kinky. In fact, you should put some chemical concoction in it to get rid of the kinks. Straighten it out, as they say. Now, I thought of that word kinky, but I also said, oh man, Yeezy. Phenomenal illustration of this concept. Let's depend on Yeezy for a few seconds. Tell me what I gotta do to be that guy. Set a price, go down. She ever fuck a black guy? Or do anal? Or do a gangbang? It's kinda crazy that's all considered the same thing. Well, I guess a lot of niggas do gangbang. And if we run trains, we all in the same gang. Runaway slaves all on a chain gang. Bang, 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 bang. Much obliged, Yeezy. He's talking to a porn star, not Kim Kardashian. Har, 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 har. But he's talking to a porn star, following the lyrics. And he says, she said her price goes down if she ever F's, has sex with, a black guy, or does anal, or does a gangbang. He can kind of crazy. That's all considered the same thing. That is exactly, and I mean 5,000% what she meant. There is an implied sexual degeneracy with niggers, and white people know this. That's why, what have we been reading? Old Jeff Dahmer. I didn't even want to read this goofy book, and we're almost done. They drugged me to the finish line. Woo. In the process of being dragged, James Byrd, old Jeff Dahmer repeatedly, Tracy Edwards, Ronald Flowers, these are some of the black males who escaped Jeffrey Dahmer. Both of these privileged black males talk about going, running to the police for help in Wisconsin, and they look at it and say, you having some sort of, you know, freaky sex, y'all in some sort of homosexual activity. That's even the stance that they took when it was the little Laotian teenage boy. It was the same thing. Oh, we got these old freaky lovers. Like, I'm going to go get the Laos. That's how they think of black people, period. Non-white people, period. At least that's the projection. Then you can go out and do all your Jerry Sandusky and everything, because, I mean, hey, they're kinky by nature anyway. And
you got the whole global just on the cows from this year, you know, white people all over the universe think of black people with this sense of implied sexual degeneracy, because we were talking to a white woman in South Africa who wrote a chapter about this, as it applies to black males. We just heard this exactly from a white man talking about Brazil, where they said a black male footballer, they talked openly, and this was 21st century, white people talked openly about this black dude who was famous. Oh, you got to be careful. Oh, my God, he's got that big black penis. Like, oh, my God, he'll rape all the ladies and all the dudes. He'll rape us, too. Oh, my God, got the dog in the corner. Watch him. Watch him. You got to keep an eye on the dog, because he'll rape the dog, too. Like, oh, my God, the nigger penis. Dr. Pitts talked about this. He said, man, who even said that the black male is gay? How do you know? He's, you know, into all of it. And he's got that big penis. He's got to do something with it. He'll rape us all. Watch the dog. Keep an eye on the dog. And just like kinky in Portuguese, Dr. Draper told us this year the term in Portuguese is crespo. It means the exact same thing both ways, pun intended. Curly, sexual deviance. He indulged us to explain the term crespo during his spring visit. But yes, I thought that was important, something to keep in mind. That's how they think about all of us, boys and girls included. Anywho, let's see. Last thing that was not directly included in the sound clips, although this is a news item, reading more important than watching television. As I was not feeling well, I had to be down quite a bit, even had to postpone some programs, and just a little less active than I would have been normally. I took the time to watch. There was a documentary I saw, caught my attention. I had missed it. It came out this year. I would have watched it when it came out in April. American Manhunt. It is about the Boston Marathon bombing. All the bomb talk that we've had this year, that is an April bombing, just like, you know. Anyway, I'm looking at this documentary with keen interest because we've talked about this case for a decade. When it first happened, racial classification confusion, the Tsarnaev brothers, are they classified as white? We did a whole program. Susan Vodachinko, white woman, guest on the program, talked about her report. The Tsarnaev brothers are Caucasian, not white. And she came on the program days after the bombing to explain why that is. And even told us, if you had the chance to talk to Jokar Tsarnaev, the one that's still alive, if you had the chance, he would probably explain to you, no, we are not accepted as white. And further, that's why we did this. Three-part documentary, American Manhunt. Oh, man, my attention went through the roof. Metaphor, my attention spiked. Even when I'm sick, congested, sniffling, disgruntled, I'm viewing, number one, they do the police bulletin. I say, oh, wait a minute. The police bulletin, you already know. Police bulletin, they don't just give random information. It gets real specific. Be on the lookout. White male. 6 feet. 200 pounds. Boom, boom, boom. I mean, hey, they will. Negro male. Be on the lookout. Rape the white woman. Boom, boom. I mean, that racial classification, that's one of the first things. I'm listening. What do they say? They give the police call out. It is. What? Actually, let me give it in order. They start, the first one was Caucasian. I said, whoa. the title of the dang report that we had from Dr. Vodachinko was Caucasian, not white. So I'm still waiting. Except maybe they'll say white at some point. I wait. As the documentary three parts continues, they get to the second part. They start flashing government documents on the screen. Oh, man, I get my energy boost. Let us use the HD, get the clicker, start slowing it down. Boom, boom, boom. They finally get to the passport and driver's license and all that good stuff that has the box. Race, bang, stop right there. Let's see. Nothing is marked for the race box. Oh. All of the sniffling discomfort I could muster. They got all the other information filled out, date, height, weight, all this other useless nonsense. Nothing for the race boxes? Now, even that is kind of, Who is classified as white where you would not put that on the form? Okay, screenshot that, keep rolling. We get further along. Now we get another police update. Whoop, I pay attention again. This time they say Middle Eastern. Now that is not a racial classification, but buddy, that is kind of far from white. And they said Middle Eastern, one of them light-skinned. Said what? What? Is that on the census box? Light-skinned Middle Eastern? Do they put that on any of the... That's a racial classification? We continue, and they go through putting up a few more forms and documents and people talking about them and when they got here and showing photographs. Particularly, they started showing photographs of where these folks lived, the Tsarnaevs, where they lived here, people that they hung out. Oh, my. By the time I got to the end of that documentary, I already thought, these are two non-white people. By the time I got to the end, it was 5,000%, no doubt, not white. Now, I do remember there was a lot of confusion about this. VGQ, individuals classified as white, they do the deciding about racial classifications. That said, oh man, I do remember some of the reasoning behind the people who thought that they were not white. Some of the folks said the Rolling Stone article cover that featured the younger brother who's still alive, Jokar Tsarnaev, and saying, oh man, if that had been, pick, you know, the black person, O.J. Simpson, you know, any other black person that has been accused of some sort of crime, Christopher Dorner, whatever it is, they would not be on Rolling Stone posed like they're some sort of grunge artist and ooh, and make them look attractive. Like, no way, get out of here. That was one. And then the other compelling bit of evidence was the fact that the younger, the one that's still alive, he was not going to get the death penalty. They even covered that in the documentary. So they did originally sentence him to the death penalty. It was appealed and overturned. They took that to the Supreme Court and it was reinstated. Now, I said way back then, hey, James Byrd Jr., white people do execute other white people. They killed two of the white dudes that killed James Byrd Jr. in Jasper, Texas. They do kill white people from time to time. That said, I do not. Death penalty or no, no way. I do not think the Tsarnaevs classified as accepted as white. No way. Not even close. Particularly, they even, in the document, they start including, once they start showing the photos and all that, oh, these sand Negro Muslims, what in the terrorist country? Gotcha. Okay. Some of the reports that we did hear today. Number one, they got the, well, I guess we heard two different reports about Seattle. I hope everyone, I think I've mentioned it a few times. I only learned recently, like within the last 12 months, that Sir Mix-a-Lot great American entertainer, crooner, that's Posse on Broadway is an ode to Seattle. Some of the very streets and intersections that he mentions in that song are in the Central District, 23rd and Union. That would be one right there. Puts you smack dab in the middle of the Colored District, as it is affectionately known. The Liberty Bank Project, that is to attract black people, residents, in the core of Seattle. I've been by that complex many times. The new Africa Town or Africa Village, what it's called, that's right across the street. I think that's 23rd and that's 23rd and Union, I think. Not 23rd and Jackson, but either way, still right there in the Central District. All of that is right across the street from a PCC. Some of our Washington listeners know that's one of the more pricier grocery stores here. They do have very good vegan pizza. All of these two major complexes in the Colored District, they are also directly next to a recreational dispensary, of course. Of course. Let's see. When they were specifically talking, the segment, the first Seattle segment was about the housing, and then the second segment was about the Wing Luke Museum in Seattle, which is in the International District Chinatown, which is pretty much downtown, not that far from the Central District. They were talking about the recent racist attack at the Wing Luke Museum. That one hit me personally because we, the COWS, has broadcasted live from the Wing Luke Museum. In fact, that program, we had Professor Trask visit us from Hawaii, talk about racism, white supremacy on the islands, and that is one of the very few programs where Justice and Gus T broadcasted together from the same building, the Wing Luke Museum. Able to check out some of the artifacts and all that good stuff, include that as we were there. But I've been there a few times. I'm not surprised. In fact, I was even there. They mentioned Donnie Chin as being one of the former protectors, non-white male, of that area. I was in Chinatown in 2015 when they did the memorial. Yes, memorial observation. He had just passed or been killed a few days before, and it was a huge outpouring of people. I think the chief of police came, and the mayor at the time came, and lots of folks, and, you know, wanted to acknowledge and appreciate Mr. Chin for the work that he did. Counter-racism effort, really. That's what they talked about. But a sledgehammer, they talked about the white dude that went and attacked the museum with a sledgehammer, and that he has a record of racist attacks against non-white people in Chinatown in this area before. Man, they talked about the slow response and all that, and perhaps we could have a more nuanced and sensitive response to this sort of thing. I have no idea what that means. I think for most of the white people that I have been around, if it was someone with a sledgehammer or other weapon and they're causing major destruction to property and racist insults, I think most of them, especially if they were saying something anti-white, like, oh yeah, like rock and roll, get the pepper spray, forget that, get the Glock, where is the ammo? Like, they are not messing around. Why do I have my concealed carry permit? You got a sledgehammer. Show you what we do to folks with a sledgehammer. Let's see. And that even reminded me of the reports that they had about somebody downtown terrorizing people with a hammer. Like, man, oh man, Seattle. Like, everything is bad, particularly with the drugs. Jesus, the fentanyl situation is so terrible. I posted it online. They're closing the Target department store in the U District, right? So this is literally University of Washington. You walk two blocks from the main campus Target. Super convenient. The students come in. I just said this, the fall quarter started last week. I never shop at that Target. I just tried to go to get like a quick beverage on my way to work, and bang, it was like 50,000 people. I was like, I didn't even get it. I left with it. That store is closing in 2 weeks because they set up all the crime and it's unsafe. Most of the drugs and the Ave, as that street is affectionately known, it has been unsafe and high crime like forever. Since I first got here, It has just gotten worse, I would submit, with all of the fentanyl and extra drugs over the last 3-4 years. But it has been horrible the whole time. I'm even thinking, like, how do you have a major institution, student body close to 50,000, and you can't, you come on campus and, whoa, don't go to that. Whoa, gotta be careful over there. They couldn't even keep a target there. This crime is so bad. Lord. That is embarrassing. Like, man, I wouldn't even want my parents to come. They like, whoa, let me get you at the airport. Don't want you to mess around. Got all the fentanyl has gone crazy. I'm skipping ahead just to that report, Dr. Leana Wen. That was Baltimore Public Radio, where she was talking about these psychedelics and people self-medicating and how she does not support that as a medical doctor. That sounded so much like Dr. Frances Cress Welsing a decade ago. She even said, all these psychedelics and things, this is following the same path as cannabis, isn't it? In fact, I can back up. Oh, worthless Negro Gus T. Renegade. Oh, Gussie Wussie did say, with white people, it's not gonna just be, let's have recreational cannabis. Oh, no. It's gonna be, let's have recreational heroin. Let's have recreational LSD. Let's have recreational cocaine. Recreational mushrooms. Recreational everything. Yes. And now you see some of that. Come to Seattle. Come to Portland. Do you think all of these widespread available narcotics, I don't even know how many people we can kill with all of this. You got the fentanyl floating around. Do you think, yes, that is sending us the direction we need to go? Are you out of your flipping mind? For many of us, yes. Oh, okay. Got it. No, that is not the direction we need to go at all. Sobriety would be best. I think she even said, like, dang, for the people that are on that self-medicating, like, these studies were done under very controlled circumstances, not willy-nilly, take however much you want, got it from who knows who, with who knows what in it, and all of the side effects that you might be more susceptible to. They were talking about suicide and all the rest of this, which, again, Dr. Welsing said a decade ago. Man, as a medical doctor, I'm seeing clients who are consuming cannabis and are now showing symptoms of psychoses. Man, that's what they've been talking about more recently. Sobriety would be best. We do not need magic mushrooms. Justice. Anywho, let's see. I'll just get to the gut health. I'll get in my two, and then we'll get to the folks who dialed in. That bit about the gut health, I think, so important. They said this is something that, you know, they're still studying, still learning. Echo. One thing that I can say, now that is true, that's something that I see here in Seattle, along with all the explosive drug use. They do have lots of products marketed to those white people with those six-figure incomes. Hey, get this tincture and this tea and this organic whatever for gut health, probiotics. They call them. One thing that they did leave out, if we're really talking about gut health, some of this in Dr. Shauna Swan's book, Countdown, and also Judith Finlayson's You Are What Your Grandparents Ate. Not eating all of that high processed, ultra processed foods, not eating out where you're probably going to be eating a lot of prepackaged foods in plastic, eating more whole foods, fruits and vegetables, and even cooking yourself so that you can minimize having to consume all that plastic and all the rest of it, eating fresh fruits and vegetables that you've prepared. And when you're eating more fruits, whole wheat, whole fruits, not processed and all the rest of it, juices and such, you're getting fiber. All of that helps for your gut biome. In fact, we even talked about specific prebiotics like asparagus, and the old Brussels sprouts are friends. But that right there, those are excellent choices to help. You don't have to go, you know, to wherever PCC and such and spend your whole paycheck to get, you know, this sort of tea or tincture or juice or whatever it is. Eat more whole fruits, vegetables. That right there will do wonders for your gut biome. Even I talked about eating the peel for oranges. You get organic for that. But wash them good, eat the peel, getting more fiber in there. That too helps. Even, especially if you have a Vitamix, you can put in your Vitamix. Bam, all of that helps with your gut biome. Right connected with that, I played them together, the report about the global increase of those sugary beverages. Now, they included within that report, a part of the problem is the appeal of the, they called it Western diet, white diet. That right there, that's status symbol. And we've heard that before. One of our callers in China said that. KFC and such spreading in China. Why would that be? White diet. We can show off. Go get us a big bucket of chicken. Yeah, do it like the white people. Yeah. We don't eat, you know, traditional foods like our parents. Nah, nah, nah. We don't show off. We are cool. Yeah, we eat like white people. Apparently, that is a global thing to our detriment, especially with those sugary beverages. I say that all the time, especially people, if you're struggling, you have any sort of problem with diabetes or you're trying to lose weight or anything of that nature, get rid of those sugary beverages. All of us need to consume more water. Drink water. Not sodas, not those goofy flavored waters and the teas. They didn't even get into all the Starbucks concoctions and all of that and caffeinated this and all the rest of it. Water. Just what? Now, even that, so much of that has been contaminated and poisoned and all the rest of it. You can invest in a quality water filter for your residence. You can't have it delivered. I know people who found good options for that. Costco will have really good sales on that sometimes as well. You can get it delivered or whatever the case, but drink water. Best thing possible. It is so good for you. So many of us, the vast majority of us, do not drink enough to begin with. And then you can avoid all that with the unnecessary calories and high fructose corn syrup that they snuck in there and just getting you addicted. Probably got some caffeine in there too. They were gulping down. No sugary beverages and spread that. That's what I was saying for retired firefighter when they were having the DCF program, the DCS program, excuse me. And he was saying that they were having the snacks and stuff like water, not OJ, not grape juice, not apple juice. And I even saw a player today and they said his name was Kool-Aid. Like, the worst. Water, drink water. All right. Last one, could say the Golubski case, we'll get to that. The case with Alonzo Brooks, we talked about that before. Henry in Chicago had mentioned that. I think some other people had said that they saw that from Unsolved Mysteries. 20 years on, they are still fumbling and stumbling and all the rest of it. Now, I know there is no statute of limitations on murder, but I mean, dang. To die at 23 out in some racially restricted region in Kansas, and we're 20 years on and still waiting, still hoping somebody can come forward and give some names and all that. Now, he was at a party with a lot of young people, so I mean, hey, it's not like these folks should be dead, ostensibly. I know we got the overdoses and fentanyl and all that, but I mean, basically, you should have a lot of folks fast forward 20 years who would be early 40s, late 30s. They should be around and not fogies with bad memories about what happened at the turn of the new millennium in Kansas, death of Alonzo Brooks. We'll see what transpires. I do think, man, all of this is in the same area. Ralph Jarl and Timothy Hazlitt, that's the white dude that had the dungeon. Janie Crosby and these other black females where they're tied up and shackled in the basement and black females going missing. Shooting of teen Ralph Jarl and Roger Golubski. All of this is in the same area. Just gives me pause. But I mean, hey, global system of white supremacy racism. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Let's see, folks who dialed in, no spectating and hanging out. If you have commentary to share, hand up. Let's see. First few folks who dialed in with a hand up, proceed.
Hello, may I be heard?
Greetings, Irie. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. Please, please, please don't fall for it with the recreational drugs. You know, you said something about they'll make heroin, recreational cocaine. Heck, yeah, they probably will. They've made food recreational when you think about it. Like the way people eat, they eat for sport, literally. People eat because they like the taste and they're addicted. Sounds like recreation. I don't want to talk about too much detail, but because of the, I'll call it the incoming or oncoming victory over cannabis addiction in that process, my son was accused of disorderly conduct a couple months ago for an event, and we're in court about that, and that's how serious it gets. Like, we didn't even know that there were accusations of or citations for a while until recently. So just watch your kids, monitor them, and encourage them once they turn 18 or whatever it is in your state to be able to buy, you know, the Delta 8s and the 9s and cannabis. Just encourage them not to, because there's consequences and it's a trap. Speaking of that, when they were talking about mental health and the psychedelics, that's a racket. I don't know if that's a metaphor, but it's a racket. They really do want people out of their minds, and what they want to do is get people transitioned over once they're diagnosed with a mental illness. This is what I think. They'll diagnose somebody with a mental illness. They'll ignore the causation, which is the drug or the substance or whatever. And they'll especially do it if it's not one of those substances considered a narcotic, like cannabis, for instance. So they'll diagnose, oh, you're schizoid or you're bipolar or whatever. And then now, oh, wow, we have a drug for that. So they're pushing people to do the recreational to eventually, in my opinion, get diagnosed and then moved over to the pharmaceutical. And then leave out, again, causation. No, you're just crazy on your own, you know. Don't matter that you didn't have these problems until you started smoking, whatever. SAMHSA, is substance abuse and mental health, is some kind of grant or whatever. I forgot what the last A stands for. They're pushing this thing called mental health first aid. That's a racket, because they want people to kind of help get people to so-called first aid, so they can be diagnosed, like I said, and be put on drugs that they're not dealing with. Why the people have a mental illness, for instance, like the system making people crazy because of a system of imbalance. They don't address that. They just throwing people on drugs. So that's the mechanism that they're using to fulfill this racket in that that stuff I just mentioned about putting people on pharmaceuticals. Okay, I don't know how much time I got. So the N-word in school, with the lady. They're like wanting answers from the school. And then the school said, we investigate and we do this and we do that and we take action in accordance of our policy. Okay, well, they told you the truth. So parents, I'm going through this right now with a parent that I helped advocate for several times. You got to read the policy. Once you submit your child to the jurisdiction, I've learned from an elder teacher that I consider my the main person I want to model. He mentioned parentis in locus, which is basically Latin for you're giving parental right to the school. So you need to know the policy through and through. If the policy says when somebody uses racial slur that they only get suspension, then the fact that only suspension occurred wouldn't be a surprise if people actually read the policy. But I have a feeling the victims of racism are not, or they have and it didn't fit obviously what happened, which I agree. But if they're expecting more without knowing what it actually says, then that's part of the problem. And it should have been known ahead of time before they put their kids in that school. And then the last thing, the 14-year-old that killed his brother, well, second to last thing, the 14-year-old that killed his brother lived in Monticello. Isn't that the same name of the plantation Thomas Jefferson had where he raped, victim of racism in Timmins? And then the other thing, Jeffrey Dahmer's been coming up in my friend connection a lot. I was with a victim of racism, elderly woman. She lives in public housing. I was almost arrested for trying to advocate for her and her situation. And I met with her 2 days ago, and she said the police were looking for her son. It was like 10 cars that were driving around looking for her son like a manhunt. And she said, verbatim, she said they didn't even do that for Jeffrey Dahmer, but they did that for my son, and he didn't even do anything. They just thought he did something. So I'm going to mute my line. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. I told a fib. When it comes to needing to heal mentally, I feel like what I've been taught by my elders is true. It's all in us. We're able to do it, to heal ourselves and give ourselves the peace we need, but you can't access it if you're not eating right, if you're not sober, if you're not getting rest. Like you said, if your brain is competing with itself just to stay alive, no, you're going to not understand that you have the ability to access that inner peace, and you're going to look for it externally. So, again, moral of the story, sobriety is best. Thank you.
Much obliged, Irie. Monticello, yes, that is the name of the plantation in VA where Thomas Jefferson raped Sally Hemings, the young fellas, or the 14-year-old who killed his brother and then was going to shoot up the high school. That was actually in Alabama. I think they've, what shall we say, co-opted that name, that plantation title, probably prestigious names. So they've, applied it many places. The sobriety would be best. Can't be said enough. Talk to your children about that. Even Dr. Welsing talked about that in terms of medicinal benefits. Dr. Leana Wen, she was saying the same thing. We heard her today talking about the same thing, where they talk about these so-called benefits for certain patients who have certain medical conditions, and that might be true. But that is very different from all of this, widespread recreational use, what they call self-medicating. We just do whatever you want to because, you say you're having a tough time, which may or may not be true, but that's not to say all this, doping and narcotics is going to make anything better. That is not what a racist man, racist woman have intended for all of this, all these recreational drugs and such. Not even close. The school component, I do not have children. Irie is a parent. I am not. But in terms of her recommendation, if you do have children, you're going to send them to school, read the policy and procedure, same way we talk about it for the workplace, that way, and read it with your child. I know when I was in school, sometimes they would take a whole class at the beginning of the school year, like now, and go through the whole student handbook, beginning to end, so that everybody's informed about the expectations, what's going to happen. We don't have any surprises. Like, what? Y'all do what? I never, we went through it. Same thing. You can even do it before the school year starts. You don't have to do it in one shebang because it could be long, but you could take 15 minutes, half hour, each night for like a week, go through the whole thing. Any questions, anything pops up, they know what's supposed to happen, these sort of situations. And as she was saying, for the parents, their child is being terrorized, racist slurs, and all the rest of it, they even can use language to go in so that you say, this is not just a racial slur, this is, you know, a terrorist act or whatever, a more severe violation. So, hey, this is supposed to be bang sort of punishment based on what's in handbook, page 15, paragraph 3, that type of thing. Reading the handbook, very important. Workplace and school, same thing, really. That's the way you explain it to your child, same thing. Workplace, school. Read the handbook and expect racists to break the rules. This way you'll be in the know when they're violating their own policy and procedure. Much obliged, Irie. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943, pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Old Jeff Dahmer, we will be done with his father's memoir this Thursday. We'll wrap it up in the Catherine Massey Book Club. I didn't want to read the book, but I was willing because I said it short. Knew we would be done in four, so we'll wrap it all up, even though I have learned quite a bit. And it took quite a bit of time and a number of bodies to start piling up before they even mobilized for Jeffrey Day. At first, like I said, it was, we got these old freaky dark people out, you know, go get me a shower. I'm not worried. They were not sending no squad or legion and SWAT team and all that for old Jeff Dahmer at first either. It took a while, quite a few dark bodies to stack up before, maybe you should investigate old Jeff. And we'll get to that later. Book Club Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Let's see. I did also want to get in the report that we heard from the Wall Street Journal. They gave the report about their using technology to intercept, we'll say, young men, they said, who are angry. They're filled with rage. And they want to catch these young folks before they get all riled up, decide that they want to carry out maybe some violence type of thing, you know, Peyton Gendron type of a thing. I said, man, why are we, that's what I talk about all the time, all that pussyfooting, like if it's white men that we're talking about, I don't think you mean Ben Crump is around here mad. People keep calling him the way that they're treating black people, and I'm mad. I keep having all these cases, and then they get, the black people get mad at me when I can't get the result that they want to and all that, and I'm, ooh, it's frustrating. I'm mad. That's not, you know, who they're talking about. Al Sharpton, other black dudes, mad. Dottison remedial reading. Didn't get the, that's who, not who they're talking about. You mean white men. You should say that. That's the same thing I told Dr. Neoclaus, where consistently white people don't get named and identified. That's the problem. That's who we're talking about in all of this. That, the fact that it's not being named specifically as this is a white dude problem, that would further to me suggest that you're not really serious about addressing all of this. Because when it was black people and crack or anything else, you got no problem coming out and the Negroes got to get their act together. Tired, got their pants. Why don't we get Al Sharpton and do something, make them pull their pants up, get them belts or something, see? Old Julie Jargon, that was the Wall Street Journal report, a new effort to rescue men, rescue even, from the rage rabbit hole. See all that old nonsense, metaphors and such? Are you talking about? That's Wizard of Oz. We're not in Kansas anymore. What are you talking about? You're talking about somebody going to get a gun? They go online and get a copy of the Anarchist Cookbook, go make some pipe bombs. I'm going to go shoot up the high school, kill my brother first, and go shoot up the high school? Come on, man. We've been talking about that for 20 years, man. That's Reb and Dill. That's not even a new phenomenon. They were mad, angry, sitting, teeming with rage. Y'all didn't give me no comment. We read about all that. That's been going on for 25 years, man. Get it together. Any hoodles. Let's see. Give folks 5 minutes. See if they have comments, observations, suggestions to share. Again, the race soldiers blocked me, all the good white people at Meta, Zuckerberg and the like, have still been blocked from Facebook and being sick, not feeling my best. I'm not devoted the time to go and see if I can get unblocked so I can get back posting and such on Facebook. That is one way you can invest in the cows. Make sure you share the broadcast, any of your social media sites and such. Share the program if you think it would be constructive so folks can hear Dr. DeTaut, Compensatory Call-In, hear the Catherine Massey Book Club and old Jeffrey Dahmer. Maybe get some tidbits that people didn't see in the Netflix series this past year and such. Anyway, since we're talking about privileged black males, that report that was talking about the arrests in Miami-Dade County specifically, they said that, I even had to write it down because I was staggered, they said that 9% of the population, black dudes, 52% of the arrests, black boys. That, I mean, like, wow. Even I had to go back and look at the report, like, dang. If that, I mean, unless it's just, hey, black males, black boys in particular, like, oh my God, they cannot be saved. We just can't do nothing with them. They're running amok. They're raping everyone. We can't even have the Hard Rock Cafe open in Miami because of black boys. Oh my God. We thought that no count Jameis Winston was bad, but I mean, woof, they out of control. Dang, that would be another one. DCS meeting, like, play that report, like, oh my God. Woo. Even retired firefighter had told us, like, when you talk to some of the young black boys, like, how would you respond? You get stopped by the police, and they would say, man, I'd smack them in the face. Like, you don't tell me what to do. My name is Leroy. You know where I was going. Like, whoa, woo. Show them that report. Like, it is very likely the police are going to want to put their mitts on you at some point. It happens to a lot of black boys down here. Be prepared. In fact, try to be preemptive. That's what we talk about, being sober. I don't do all the hanging out late. I don't do all the partying. I don't go, you know, it's going to be 5,000 people, you know, at the after party and going to the beach. I'm going to miss out on this one, y'all. Post some good shots on IG. I'll watch it later. I'm going to pass on that one. That would be the way I would try to explain this. Like, hey, you know, I'm all for having a good time and such, but wow. The police down here put their mitts on a lot of black boys. In fact, now, within the audio report, they said 9% of the population are black dudes. 52% of the arrests are black dudes. The article title actually said report finds that black boys compromise 63% of arrests. So that's even a smidge up from what was actually said in the report. Either way, like, dang, the majority of arrests, black. Oh, bah, bah. Parenting, tough job. I would be mandatory. Any of those types of reports, it would be mandatory. Sit your child down. Talk it over with them. They can share their thoughts. You can share yours. Maybe if they have friends and such, they can talk about it too. But that these are the type of things they should be thinking about to help inform their conduct and decision-making overall, maybe even something that they can talk about with some of their black friends to help improve their decision-making. And this helps drive everything else home so that it's not just mom, dad, grandma, auntie coming to nag us again. Don't be hanging out. Oh, this is all that where he's pestering in system of racism and all that. Oh, yeah, I see. Yeah, they do grab a lot of black boys. Got it. All eyes on me. Yes, I see. We'll keep that in mind when we are out in public. Gotta be like a squirrel. That's the way Mr. Fuller. Gotta be like a squirrel. Gotta be cautious. Dangerous out here. Any hoodles. Let's see. Folks might be spectating or doing their other things and such. Hopefully, I was all looked to be booked and be rolling, getting our guests and everything scheduled, but I did not anticipate getting a little bit sick, a little under the weather, and then they would take a few days to fully recoup and be ready to roll. So once I'm feeling presto, I will reschedule some of the broadcasts that we missed that would have taken place over the past few days while I was trying to recoup. Hopefully we'll be able to get those scheduled in sometime for the coming week and later on in October. I was so excited. It was such, if anything, it was a great reminder for Gus T. Do not take your health for granted. I'm standing by my work saying, hey, we did 21 programs for the month of September, 20 programs for the month of August, 41 programs over the last 60 days, August, September, standing by our work. But to do that, you do have to take at least reasonably good care of yourself. If I had to worry about my diabetes and my sugar and all that the whole time, like Miss Ophelia, one of Roger Golubski's victims, might have been a bit more challenging to do, was that 41 programs, 60 days. Take it, that's why I talk all the time. Drink more water. Put those Funyuns down. Put those chicken nuggets down. Put that sugary drink down. No sodas. No high fructose corn syrup. Eat those Brussels sprouts. Nothing can replace your health. Let's see. Other folks dialed in with a hand up. If you have commentary to share, proceed. See, our caller in Florida should be with us. Nab other hands.
Yes, sir. May I have you heard?
Yes, sir. Caller in Florida.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to us, the host, the listeners, and caller. I thought about that the number two about what they were saying. I think it was 70 or 17% black males in the area, and they make up for like 50-something% of the arrest. That's very powerful to hear that number, that statistic. The segment where they were talking about the black female student, I think a senior, had to put on the headphones or the earbuds to try to not hear the racial slurs or the acts of racism. And the parent that was in the storm. And I don't know if that was the same segment where I think they were talking about the hecklers, I think that's the term that they use, and this new generation of racist white supremacists students at the school, and they just come up with all these different ways to practice white supremacy, the racism and the jokes. They put in the symbolisms, go to the games, all kind of ways, bring it to the schools and the hallways. And once again, I'm glad that you play that segment, the audio with President Obama. And they are better. So there was a part where one of the parents were sounding frustrated, like, you know, we try to say something about it and they just don't really care. They still don't do nothing about it. I guess they said that they were suspended from off of the bus or something like that. And it's really, I don't really see that being much of a consequence either. And that made me think also about the other segment where they were talking about the juvenile laws and how they couldn't disclose the name, I guess because of the person is a minor. But I know where if it was somebody black, like down in Ocala, the two black males, they named them. And then once again, they had one with his shirt off, as they say, doing the perp walk. So they named them, you know. But I don't know, maybe it's because that was in, I think, Alabama or a different state. And then the guy tried to rationalize, well, you know, that other guy, that juvenile, see, they named him because he was at large or something like that. So I don't get what made that different than this case. There's still a violent crime being committed. Someone been murdered or harmed. Like, shouldn't that be at large, too? I don't know. But other than that, that's all I have to share. Thanks for the programs, and I'll continue to listen. Thanks for allowing me to share.
Much obliged, caller at the courthouse. I think they would say for the Alabama situation that since the previous young person that they named, who was 14, he was on the lam. They were trying to apprehend him. So they said it was a compelling public safety interest to go ahead and name this 14-year-old miscreant, as opposed to if you're 14 and you kill your family and then maybe you're going to shoot up the school, but they got you in custody. Like, that's not, you know, imminent public danger. Like, we got him. He's cuffed. You know, we got him in custody, so you don't need to worry about, you know, little Tad, we got him, as opposed to, Lord, Tad might kill somebody. Like, let us, if you find him and, you know, put his face up and all that, like, you know, that doesn't seem different. That seems the same to you.
I can see that being different. So, I guess they had apprehended the person that they already, that they put a name out for, or I guess I might have just gotten it confused. But the person, the more recent person, I guess they had already caught him. Is that what you're saying, Gus?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Okay, now I see why. All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, I will be curious with the more recent case where they got him in custody. He didn't escape, you know, if they decide that these circumstances warrant this person being tried as an adult. Like, I've seen that with some of these school cases where they threaten to go, especially post-Columbine, you threaten to go and shoot up the school and bomb the school or whatever. And you got a hit list. You got people, looks like you're serious. This was not just a joke or one-off type of a thing, and you killed somebody too. You killed your own brother. Like, I don't know, he might be named eventually. It depends on how they adjudicate this case. We'll have to see. But man, that is Columbine through and through. Got the hit list and all, just like old Dill and Red. They didn't do the kill the family members, you know, but still. Anywho, much obliged, caller at the courthouse. And I thought the same thing with, we had a bunch of those reports about the school situation last week, a surprising number. And then this week we heard from some of the parents of the victims, and they said, dang, our children, you know, they have to be subjected to all this, and here come these colored people, and oh, God, and nigger this and all the rest, and they don't do anything about it, or, you know, just tell them they can't ride the bus for, you know, 1 or 2 days, or no serious punishment or what have you. What sort of impact does that have? You got to get on the bus or whatever to go to school. And it's the same thing that they said last week. They were in California, but same thing. I said, getting up and going to school, it's like going to hell. That's the same thing. We got to get up, be on the bus. Me, one or two, you know, other black children. We're the only little girls on the bus or whatever. And we get, oh, God, here comes this nigger. Oh. I got to put my headphones on, put my head down. Like, oh, man, I hope we get to school soon. Hope we get to school soon. Hope we get to school soon. Who wants to learn after all that? Like, really? And how many generations of black children have been subjected to that? That's the type of thing that I'm saying. Like, really, at this point, we heard that they said that this week is 2023. Like, okay, we got it. We'll be saying the same thing. It's 3023. I can't believe. Yeah, yes, yes. Dedication to racism, white supremacy. That's what that means. Now, to move on solving this problem, in my view, before you get to the bedroom, Bay Area mom, genius, sometimes it's so simple. Sometimes it's not rocket science. It's, hey, you don't have to have the children. Nobody said don't have sex. Nobody said that. You don't have to have the children. We should be done with this. Like, should be no more is too, exactly. We start off the same way they did, but we don't finish the same. It's 2023. I am not, we are not sending another generation of black children to this. We're done with that. We're totally done. That is a dereliction of duty. It's before you get to the bedroom, if you don't have at least a halfway plan, we can't do this. We putting them on the bus. And is this Ruby Bridges, man, in the same spot? We've been doing the same thing for 60, like that. We got to do something else. Got to do something else. That means no children until we move to a spot where they got black schools, black teachers, fine. Get things together where we got homeschool, fine. Get someplace, get relatives to organize. You can have independent school there, have people to pitch in, relatives and what have you pitch in for homeschool, fine. But if it can't be something else, we have done that for generations. We're just not going to keep doing the same thing, or we will keep getting the same result, and we'll be sitting here. It is 2053. It is 2075. It is 2097. Yep, yep, and we are still in a system of white supremacy racism. All areas of people activity and black children still suffering in the killing fields, as Minister Farrakhan called them 30 years ago. Let's see. Anything else folks need to make sure they get in? Give folks 60 seconds to get a hand up, then we can wrap it all up. I will be sure to tweet out. Hopefully I'll have my Facebook page privileges back so I can post online, all that good stuff, so you can see when we will be coming up next broadcast. Folks have any tips you think it would be helpful, bang, you can also post information for the cows here so that we'll know, be informed. Let me know if you can think of some ways that would be helpful to share the context of white supremacy. Listener-supported counter-racist radio. hit the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com, racism-notes.blogspot.com, listener-supported counter-racist radio. You'll see in the top right corner, button for PayPal, Cash App, Venmo. Huge thanks to all of the folks who have invested for 14-plus years. The address for Cash App is cash.app/$thecows. Hopefully we've been worthy of your time and energy for thousands of programs at this point. Accurate most of the time, hopefully. Let's see. Also want to make sure I got in a request, if possible. I always say strive for accuracy. I think anyone who's listened to this broadcast before has heard me say that maybe 5-10 times, perhaps. The program that we did, already mentioned, with Dr. Brian Pitts on sexual abuse of black males in Brazil, South America, back to the Western Hemisphere. So we did that program right at the end of September, last week, really. One of the folks, listeners, left their comment on this episode on our Podchaser site. There are many sites where you can access the Cows archives, Podchaser, YouTube, Podbean, Amazon Music, Spotify Music, and blah, 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 long list, Apple Music, lots of sites. Anyway, Podchaser, person left their comment for the episode with Dr. Brian Pitts. Their comment was good info, wish he could have stayed longer than 30 minutes as he provided a lot of good context. If I could make a request of the commenter, CrazyLover11, I do say strive for accuracy, and for this broadcast specifically, Dr. Pitts, in writing, had said he was only going to stay with us for 15, 30 minutes, and I asked, bargained, to get him to stay longer. He actually stayed with us for over an hour. I don't know if you got to listen to the whole broadcast or got distracted, but I do say strive for accuracy. This comment is not accurate, and it would tend to have people might even read and say, oh, the guest didn't even stay that long. Maybe Gus got on his nerves or what have you. So if you could post accurate information, if it's I wish he could have stayed for 2 hours, I wish he could have stayed longer, all of that would be fine. But the guest was here for substantially longer than 30 minutes, and Gus T had to fight specifically, bargain specifically, to get him to stay for double a half hour. Actually, he was here longer than that. He was here long enough for some of the listeners to get in a question and for us to get in a lot more detail than we would have had for 30 minutes. And in fact, I adjusted. I knew he wasn't going to be here for the full broadcast. We didn't even do an intro for that program so that we could get right to it. So it is a very concentrated 60 minutes plus of Dr. Pitts to discuss sexual abuse of black males in South America. And Dr. Pitts, white gay man who talks about his sexual attraction to dark-skinned black males in South America and North Carolina. No way we could have covered all that in 30 minutes. Accuracy is important. We'll assume folks are satisfied. Much obliged for tuning in for your Saturday evening. Can't say it enough times, enough ways. Sobriety would be best. That is something to model for your children. I would even say, hey, even for those of us who cut corners and such, as they say many folks do with their religion, except the religion of white supremacy, even if you take a nip every now and then, at least talk a really good game, especially for the children. Sobriety would be best. That right there for the children in Miami, South Florida, and globally. But man, if the police are out to put their hands on black boys like that, we want to do all that we can to minimize our risk. We are sober. That's one thing. Check out that. Nobody's got a call for that. And if they do come, we're sober so we can think and make the best possible decisions to survive these encounters. Model sobriety for the little folks. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. They had the great Northwest Chocolate Festival was in town today. I'd actually thought about going. If I had been feeling better, maybe would have gone, because it was really pretty today in Seattle too. It's like 75 degrees, felt like summertime. I maybe would have gone and tried to get some audio for the Jeffrey Dahmer Book Club coming up this Thursday, but check that out if you're interested. They call it one of the greatest events this part of the world. People come down from Canada and all over the world. The Pacific Northwest Chocolate Festival. All that chocolatey goodness. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.